Hello, everyone, and welcome to another edition of A Reader's Paradise. I'm so glad that you guys are here with me today and are ready to enjoy the show. Also, I want to take a moment to wish everyone well. I hope you and your family are safe wherever you are in the world as we as humans deal with this pandemic. So I know that the show has not had a lot of episodes over the last few weeks. That is because I have really been focusing on producing and narrating and getting the story or the podcast, my other podcast, Lenny Gray, going. And that podcast is going really, really well. So if you haven't had a chance to listen to the podcast, Lenny Gray, please take a moment and, you know, after you listen to this podcast, pop on over and take a listen. That's Lenny Gray, LENNIE GRAY, two words, Lenny Gray. It's a really, really wonderful podcast. So I'm not going to weigh your ears down with a lot of chatter. I know you came to this podcast to listen to either interview or listen to story. So with that being said, let's jump right into our next story. But first, let us take a deep breath. Here we go. Carmen swiveled her wrist to glance at her wristwatch as she shuffled up the steps of Nikki's apartment building. It was 6 a.m. on Saturday, and the Chicago air was already heavy with sweaty humidity. "I hate this sticky, clammy weather," Carmen complained as she wiped perspiration from her forehead and the base of her neck. "Nikki had better have her behind out of bed," Carmen muttered as she noticed a peculiar, scruffy-looking man exiting the brick building. The man was wearing a green t-shirt and cut-off blue jean shorts with black grime stains on the thighs. The grungy man had a face that only a mother could love and reminded Carmen of the scrawny rock and roll icon Mick Jagger. As Carmen approached the entrance, he held the door open for her. "Thank you," she whispered as she eased by him and walked over and pressed a silver button on the wall to call for the elevator. She stared mindlessly at the orange elevator light paused on the 8th floor. She sighed impatiently, then turned around to look out a nearby window while she mulled over her thoughts. Carmen was disillusioned with the fact that Nikki wasn't doing anything useful with her life. Her baby sister had a day job at an adult bookstore as a peep show girl and an evening job as a stripper at a seedy gentleman's club. Their parents had to be turning over in their graves, knowing that Nikki was making a living, exposing her body to men old enough to be her grandfather. That wasn't the way either of them were raised. "Yeah," Carmen whispered to herself as she continued to glance out the window. "Nikki's life is dreadful, in my opinion." Carmen shouldered much of the blame for Nikki's appalling lifestyle, and the guilt she toted around was a heavy burden on her heart. Carmen continually attempted to clear the unspoken tension between her and her sister, but reconciling with Nikki was turning out to be a monumental task. Their mother had passed away years ago from a combination of cancer and being a perpetual worrywart. 2 years later, their father, Anthony, died. At the time of his death, Carmen was 21 years old and became guardian of her then 15-year-old sister, Nikki. The untimely loss of their father was the root of the tension between them. Nikki blamed Carmen for the death of their father, and she knew it, although Nikki hadn't verbalized it as much lately. Blame and guilt were parasites eating away at Carmen's soul, and she was tired of toting around her baggage of unhappy feelings. Carmen exhaled, hoping the shift in her breathing pattern would rid her mind of the unwanted and haunting thoughts. She turned back around to check the progress of the elevator and noticed that the scrawny man who had held the door for her was still hovering around the doorway, glaring at her. He licked his lips, flicked his tongue at her a few times, sounding like a dog slurping water, and brushed his fingers across the stubble on his chin. Carmen translated the glint in his lustful eyes and realized he was having a sexual fantasy about her in his mind. "Go to hell!" Carmen snarled at him as she flipped up her middle finger. "Damn weirdo." The man didn't seem to mind Carmen's harsh words because he continued to glare at her. "Nikki has got to stop moving into these apartment buildings filled with freaks and crackpots," she muttered as the bell on the elevator chimed. Carmen stepped inside of the elevator and pressed the third floor button. When she got off the elevator, she noticed that the hallway carpet was wet. She wrinkled her nose because the musty and moldy odor was overpowering. She moved quickly down the enclosed corridor toward Nikki's apartment. Curling her fingers into a fist, Carmen drummed on the door with her knuckles. A short moment later, Frida, Nikki's roommate, answered the door. "Hey, Frida," Carmen greeted politely as Frida allowed her access to their small, cluttered, two-bedroom apartment. The place was littered with piles of laundry that needed to either be cleaned or folded, but Carmen couldn't tell which. "Is Nikki out of bed yet?" Carmen asked, crinkling her nose while comparing the untidiness of the apartment to Nikki and Frida's chaotic and messy lifestyle.
"Why are you already asking a question? You know the answer to."
Frida scraped her fingernails up and down her belly before releasing a loud yawn that assaulted the already stale air with the rotting smell of her morning breath.
"You know damn well Nikki and I are like vampires and only function after the sun goes down."
Carmen tried to inconspicuously cover her nose with the palm of her hand. Frida's breath literally smelled like spoiled food, and its foul odor was making her dizzy.
"Well, she's the one who told me to be here this early. I've got to drop my car off at the repair shop, and she promised me that she would drive over there with me so I wouldn't have to sit there and wait while the mechanic worked on my car."
Yeah, Frida answered as she scratched the side of her neck. "She told me all about it. I think she would have left work a little earlier, but this older dude walked into the tavern and started paying her some attention. And you know how Nikki has a soft spot for older men."
"I know," Carmen answered.
She wasn't giving her full attention to what Frida said because she didn't want their conversation to last longer than necessary. The only thing she wanted her to do was to stop talking. Carmen sauntered into the kitchen area and inspected a banana sitting on the countertop. After checking it thoroughly for bruising, she decided that it appeared safe enough to eat.
"He was a nice-looking man, too,"
Frida continued, to Carmen's annoyance.
"He looked like he used to play football or something. You know, the type that probably has a large stash of money hidden somewhere."
"Mm-hmm,"
Carmen answered coyly, hoping that Frida picked up that she didn't want to continue their conversation. Carmen noticed a chair that wasn't cluttered with clothes positioned in a corner of the room. She decided to sit down and wait for her sister.
"You don't seem like you're in a talkative mood. But then again, you never are. I'm going back to my room. Besides, Francisco came over early this morning and gave me some grown man loving. My body trembles just thinking about having my ass in the air while he sucks on my sweet, juicy Spanish punani."
Carmen could not have cared less about Frida's sex life, and if her pussy was as funky as her breath, Francisco had to be one nasty motherfucker to put his face anywhere near her smelly ass.
"Yeah, whatever. You're telling me way too much information," Carmen said, and began to leave.
She was glad Frida was taking her body funk back into the bedroom.
"There's no need to be jealous, honey."
"Oh, Lord, here we go," Carmen thought. "Now she thinks I'm being insulting."
"You? And your stuck-up attitude will get a mental fuck you right one of these days. Hopefully, he'll be able to mellow you out some. How long has it been now since that no-good professor dumped you? What, 9 years? Or is it 10?
Frida snickered.
He had your head all messed up when he canceled the wedding on you after you spent all of your money planning this elaborate event, which you specifically told me that I wasn't invited to. I still haven't forgotten that evil shit. I'm glad he cracked your pissy little face and left you all broken up. You needed to be taught a lesson.
Frida used threatening hand gestures to emphasize her point. Frida, it's too damn early in the morning to dig up old shit and start a fight with me. I didn't come over here for that. Carmen was more than willing to bare her claws and stir up an ugly argument if Frida didn't back down.
Trust me, you do not want to toy with me this morning.
Frida chuckled. You don't scare me, honey. Not one bit.
Frida said her piece and then made her way down the narrow corridor to the bedrooms. She banged hard on Nikki's bedroom door.
Your snooty-ass sister is here,
Frida said loud enough for Carmen to hear. The animosity between Frida and Carmen was like a knife in her back that she couldn't reach. In fact, as Carmen saw it, Frida was a part of the reason that her relationship with Nikki was so sour at times.
I hope you liked that story. I know you're wondering what happens next. I know you're probably thinking, where's the rest of this story? Well, you'll just have to come back next week and tune in to hear what happens next. In the meantime and between time, go and check out Lenny Gray, my other podcast. I'm certain you will enjoy that story as well.